1940s ended by two memos. A memorandum to a finance minister and a memorandum to a citizen. And so I really encourage you to have a look at that World Bank report. My second message today is that prevention pays if it's done well, and prevention is cost effective. The World Bank calculated, World Bank economists calculated that prevention benefits in four country contexts and different hazards. So we start with Saint Lucia. For example, the bank calculated that the cost benefit ratio of protecting doors and windows in wood frame houses from hurricanes in Saint Lucia was 1.5. And if you look at other contexts, Jakarta flood, Istanbul earthquakes, and India flood in the running basin, you see that this benefit cost ratio are even higher. So clearly, prevention pays. So if it pays, why are we not doing more of prevention? Why don't people take more on prevention intervention? That's the second part of my message today. Is that you do not always have to pay more for disaster prevention. I'll take you to some of the examples that we've also looked at in this report. One is the importance of making information more accessible. So we often talk about making informed choice. To make informed choice, well, you need information. And interestingly enough, sharing of disaster or risk-related information does not happen always automatically. And disclosing where the flood plains are, where the fault lines are benefit for everybody, from the communities, from builders to insurance companies. Yet again, even if that information was assessed, identified through public funding, it's not always openly available to people. Another interesting example is the importance of early warning system to save lives and the role of weather forecasting. So you will see here how weather forecasts have become increasingly accurate over the time from the 80s to the present, and that's for the developed countries. And if you look at developing countries, you can see that they have caught up also very quickly with that. And that's not only for 3 days forecast, but we've done the same calculation for 5 days, 7 days, and 10 days weather forecast. And the potential economic benefits are huge. You see here benefit cost ratio at two digits, 35 and 40 in China, for example. Another cost-effective practice is the promotion of better building practices. We're not talking here only about developing new construction or building code. We're talking about promoting those practices. And this requires encouraging and funding from local institutions such as engineering groups and research universities, who then are better able to institute quality control mechanisms that are tailored to the local context. Increasing funding for such measures will definitely help. And I'm taking you now to the third message of my presentation. So what the World Bank is doing about it? Well, we're trying to basically integrate now more systematically disaster prevention in our program. Over the past 10 years, the thinking in the World Bank on disaster risk management has evolved a lot, especially with the establishment of the Global Facility for Disaster Reduction and Recovery in 2006. The World Bank is also responding to a growing demand from clients for assistance after natural disasters and support to prepare for future disasters. Between 2006 and 2011, the 2005 was here, the World Bank Committee on estimated 10.8 billion project or project elements related to disasters, most often in urban, water, agriculture, and rural development sectors. And again, this is based on the knowledge that if prevention is done right, it pays. And the World Bank being also